We've explored the night skies with fogs. Happened across the little pumpkin-dwelling Moggy by the name of Patch. We've brought Isla the Highland Cow bouncing into the world. And taken the sweet and thoughtful Gammy under her wing. And now, with Morag the Sleepy Cat at the center of it all, it's time for their greatest adventure yet. Lie back. Take a nice deep breath. Welcome to your next installment of your exclusive series. You all know this anyway, but from me to all of you, a humble lad from Skye, a very real person. I can't do this without you all, and I'm blessed to be able to. What a world we live in, that I can connect with you all in this way. If you'd told me this was doable 10 years ago, I probably wouldn't have believed you. But here we are. Not a day goes by I don't express thanks for this, so I'm just passing it on to you, the people I owe most of my thanks to. Enjoy the story, there is more to come. And welcome to Snooze with Sam. It was the faint tinkling of pots and pans which roused Morag from her sleep. Or was it, in fact, mugs and spoons and a boiling kettle? It was ever so difficult to decipher when still so snoozy, but no matter what it was, this was the morning ritual, and it meant that the household was awake, which also indicated that it was time for a spot of breakfast. With a big yawn and stretch, Morag unfurled herself and sprawled on the living room floor next to the fire. She noticed through squinting eyes that the sunshine was already radiating through the sheer, thin curtains. It must be a fine day outside. Supposing this was all it took for her to kick things up a gear, as she excitedly bounded through to the kitchen in a frenzy of chirrups and agreeable powers. In moments, she was being stroked and fed, much to her delight, as she slid up and down the legs of those who were in the kitchen. She wolfed down her breakfast, had a little drink of water, and before the other occupants of the house could even say, "Have a great wee day," Morag flew out of the cat flap and into the most incredible spring morning. It was only a little past 7 a.m. but the garden was already a bustle of flora and fauna. The sun looked as though it had risen about an hour prior, and there was already a real warmth about the dewy grass. Bees hung clumsily in the fresh air as they tacked and slalomed from flower to flower. A gentle breeze draped fragrant gorse blossom across everything, with notes of succulent honey and vanilla. Along the hedge borders, separating the garden from the field, were patches of deep coloured daffodils. They were a wonderful mix of canary yellow, fiery orange, and pure cotton white. All of the fruit trees were now littered with buds and bloom, and as a result, the entire garden hummed and felt so very alive. Though perhaps the most alive things were the chickens, who broke the delicate morning chorus with rather more comedic clucks and whirs. As always, Morag gave them a breath, for frankly, she could not find much in common with these simple souls, and so left them be, pottering and scratching about the flower beds. There was another reason that Morag was so excited to wake up this day, despite the wonderful weather. It was finally time. She'd been eagerly waiting for weeks now for this one great journey, one which had taken a little planning to get right. And the very best part was, she was not going to do this alone. She was going to share this journey. Today was the day that everyone, Morag, Fox, Pat, Isla and Gammy went on an adventure. She'd passed the word around to everyone individually, When the sun reaches a little over the Grampian Hills, meet me at the bottom of the stables. What if it isn't sunny? The majority of them had responded. All apart from Isla, who was so young, innocent, and full of optimism that she would dance and play as though it were the height of summer, even on the rainiest day. But Morag didn't actually have an answer for them, as she knew the weather was no guarantee at all herself. All she said was, "I have a feeling. Trust me." And so they did. And they were all as excited as she to embark on this mysterious adventure. "Where are we going?" they all pondered. And Morag simply responded, "You'll find out soon enough. I have an idea I think you'll love." Morag padded her way through to the field of sheep, and as usual, couldn't help but keep them on their toes. They watched her every move. Dozens of delicate eyes trained on her. They even stopped chewing. Bar a few, of course. She kept moving, steadily, and waited for the perfect moment, just when they thought she was passing on by. And then she stopped. Like clockwork, a few seconds passed. Then 5, then nearly 10, before at last the first sheep bottled it and sprang off in a random direction as though fearing for its very own life. Seeing this panic, the rest of them did exactly the same thing. Only because they assumed they should also be panicking at the sight of the panic. The sound of 100 brainless hooves eventually settled into the distance, and Morag sauntered casually on. She sat up on the dry stone wall, opposite the barn stables. It was so very quiet and peaceful. She couldn't help but shut her eyes a little and soak in a bit of that lovely morning sunshine. Just listening. Listening to the sounds of birdsong, buzzing insects, and distant farm machinery waking up. After a few minutes, right as the sun was hovering above the hills, the sound of excitable thumping hooves began to emerge from the back of the farm. Morag opened her eyes a little to see none other than wee Isla, now a bigger ball of ginger Highland coo fluff, cantering along towards her.
Hello, Morag. Good morning. What an amazing wee day it is. I can't wait. I'm so excited.
Isla could hardly get her words out fast enough. She was now a few months old, but still a wee calf, really, and especially at heart. It only felt like yesterday that Patch and Morag had investigated the barn and found wee Isla only a few hours old. Though that didn't stop her wanting to get out into the world, she was out dancing in the field with them as soon as she could put one hoof in front of the other. After settling Isla's excitement, the next to arrive was her very good friend, Fox. They hardly ever saw each other in the daytime. They mostly convened on night adventures, so this was a real treat.
Good day to you, pair. How lovely that we're doing this. Being out in the sunshine is such a novelty.
Hang on a second. I've just realised something. We're all ginger, and the sun's out. The next of the troop to appear was none other than Gammy, the wee deer. And then Patch was only seconds in tow. After having encountered Patch in autumn of the previous year, they'd got together plenty to share good food, mainly. If either household had something particularly tasty on offer, you'd have bet that the other was present. And then there was Gammy. Poor wee thing, so she was, limping softly through the grass. Her injured leg would never have dampened her spirits, though. Despite falling behind the herd on their recent jaunt up the hill at night, she was always positive, and lived life to the fullest, despite her difficulties. They were all thrilled to have her join the clan. Well, we're all here, so who's ready for an adventure? Morag cheered. The five of them all laughed and tippy-tapped in anticipation, and so Morag led them all down the field, following the hedge line towards the village. Everyone side-eyed each other as they approached the village canal, sneaking cautiously through the trees.
"Where are we going?"
Patch asked Gammy.
"I'm not sure. She seems to be taking us towards the water. And I'm not the best swimmer, it needn't be said."
They tiptoed through the rutted woodlands at the edge of the village, trying their best to remain as inconspicuous as possible. Though, should anyone have cared to glance their way, there wouldn't be much chance of two cats, a fox, a deer, and a cow going unnoticed. But this didn't deter Morag, as she encouraged them to emerge from the trees, up onto the cobbled path where the water's edge lay.
"There she is,"
Morag whispered. The other four furry friends leant out from the cover of the leaves with mouths hanging open and eyes wide.
"You're joking, Morag," Fox said. "Really? This is your plan?"
Before them, nestled in the canal, moored up with jute rope, was a stupendously elegant narrowboat, gleaming beneath the morning sunshine. It was painted in mainly two colours, a deep British racing green and a soothing, almost turquoise blue. Hand-painted gold pinstripe ran up and down the sides and finished in little Celtic flourishes towards the bow and stern. Adorning these were rather ornate-looking rope bump stocks, hanging from ancient and pretty-looking chains. Running the full length of the boat was a floating deck of reclaimed teak, seemingly balanced on the roof, but actually held up by strategically located posts. The whole vessel looked like the fairy tale love child between a 60s British racing car and an Italian Riva Acquarama. What was initially shock for the four others steadily turned to intense fascination and lust. She was spectacularly beautiful and bewitching under the spring morning. But still,
they couldn't help but wonder what or how Morag was planning on using this barge. Right, everyone, don't worry. I know what you're thinking, she said, uttering calm and confident words. How in the flaming kilt of Bruce are the five of us going to get onto that boat? But I can assure you, I have been well informed by some nosy magpies that the boat's owners are away for a while, supposedly sunning themselves in the Maldives, wherever that is, and that it's been sitting here empty for ages. Patch scratched behind his ear. How did he get magpies to tell you that? Morag looked a little sheepish suddenly. I lifted the lid on the chicken food. Ach, whatever. The chickens are usually too busy digging up the garden anyways. So you really think that we can just use their boat? What will we do with it? How will we even drive the boat? Do these drive or do you sail them? How will our hooves and paws manage that? Gammy reeled with apprehension. Don't worry, everyone. I have a plan. Now, follow my lead.